Welcome to Successful Living with Bill Knapik. Every week we talk about success and everything that goes along with it. You'll learn the principles of success, how to achieve success, and learn to overcome challenges that may be getting in the way of success in your life. You'll hear from Bill Knapik, a radio personality and business development expert, along with insight from special guests. If you're ready to find your path to success or take the success you're enjoying to the next level, stay tuned. Successful Living with Bill Knapik is on right now.
And welcome to the show, Successful Living with Bill Knapik. That's me. And today, Successful Living with international best-selling author Mark Greaney. He co-authored 7 Tom Clancy novels. He originated The Gray Man. 2009, The Gray Man appears on the charts, and now his new book is called Mission Critical, another Gray Man novel. Mark Greaney, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Bill. I appreciate it.
And it would take me a half hour just to talk about all your credentials. However, let's get started. The new book is called Mission Critical, again, the Gray Man series. Let's tell people about that.
Yeah, so this is book 8 in the series. It's
wow.
been, as you said, since 2009. And it follows the story of a guy named Court Gentry, who is a former CIA paramilitary officer. And early on in the series, the CIA was trying to kill him, and he didn't know why. That was his employer. That sort of semi got ironed out, and he has a very sort of tense relationship with them now. So this book, he is working a contract for them, and he's just on a flight back to the United States from Europe after a mission. And a prisoner comes on board with another CIA team, and that prisoner is kidnapped when they land in the UK to refuel. And Court has no idea what's going on, and just goes off in pursuit because he knows that this guy holds some sort of answers to something. And so there's more of a mystery in this story as they try to unwind this plot that includes like a CIA mole. It includes North Korean intelligence and Russian criminal organizations. It's pretty much got the whole kitchen sink in there.
It sounds like super fun. And the whole idea, the first thing, if someone is not familiar with the Gray Man series and Court Gentry's other stories prior to this, Mission Critical, the new book that's now out this week, I think it grabs their attention, Mark, just the term the Gray Man. Right away, I think that is so unique in the world of all these characters that we've enjoyed through the years. But let's tell people when, I guess it was 2009, but the origination of the whole idea of the Gray Man, and what does that mean?
Well, I've done a lot of training with firearms and whatnot, and in doing that, I've met a lot of people in special forces and law enforcement and other like civilian security contractors and whatnot. And I would hear them use the term the Gray Man when they're referring to somebody who was able to move in a low profile fashion and sort of stay under the radar. He didn't wear the gear and the sunglasses and the watches and stuff that tipped off other intelligence agencies that this guy had some sort of, military background or whatever. So I had that name, and I was down in Latin America and Central America studying Spanish, and I was just in a bar in El Salvador one night, and I met this, or I didn't even meet him. I just saw this American guy. I heard him talk, sitting in the dark by himself, and he was just a lot tougher looking than everybody else that was down there. Everybody else was either language students like me or surfers if they were Americans. And this guy, I just sat there for a couple hours drinking tequila and beer and making up this backstory for him that he's a CIA officer who is being targeted, so he has to live off the grid, and he becomes an assassin for hire and in the meantime. So I just had this creative evening just making up a story about this guy, and the next morning I didn't have a book that would be overselling it, but I did have a character for a book, so that's where I went with it.
That's so exciting. And whatever profession someone's in, and we talk about success on this show, there you see you were capturing an idea while you were just out enjoying yourself for an evening, and here the idea became something. You work with it, and I guess had the sense that it was going to be something or something you're interested in developing. And other as you capture ideas, tell people about some of the things that you do to capture ideas for your books
and
characters.
Yeah, it's so interesting because, it's since I love what I do, I spend a lot of time thinking about it. So my mind just enjoys residing in that area, putting together stories. I walk my dogs for an hour at like a big off-leash dog park in my town, in my hometown of Memphis, every day. And I've probably come up with more ideas just taking my dogs on, you know, 2.5-3 mile walks than anything else. And I'll immediately jot them down because I'm terrible about, you know, telling myself I'll remember something and then being like, oh, I had something good, but I can't remember it. But I get, you know, the creative process, it does happen at the keyboard for me. But I would say overall, it happens more while I'm doing something totally random. Now, people in my you know, family and life have complained that I have, you know, I stare off into space a little bit when we're all together. But that's just sort of how the inspiration strikes me occasionally.
And that is so awesome because that happens to me. I walk my dogs every morning, and it's an inspiration does strike, and I make notes as well. And we'll tell people, you have two dogs, if I'm correct, and they are kind of a unique breed. Let's tell people a little bit about that. They love hearing about dogs.
Thank you so much for asking about my dogs. I talk about my dogs the whole time, if you let me. They're called Catahoula Leopard dogs. They're both rescues, so they both have other things in them, I'm sure.
Right.
But they're Catahoulas. It's a Louisiana breed. And we got the first one thinking he was an Australian Shepherd when he was a puppy, and it turned out he was a Catahoula. And then the second one, we went out and found another rescue Catahoula because we love the breed so much.
Yeah, they look really cool. And their names, one is named Ziggy, is that correct?
Yep, Ziggy's the 3-year-old, and Lobo is the 7-year-old.
Well, there's no question. I think dogs help us, inspire us, even when they're just sitting, sleeping, and watching us do what we do. So
absolutely.
The other thing when we think about that, as far as names, we talk about the gray man, but as you write the books, and in the book, the new book, Mission Critical, people can get it right now, other than Court Gentry, the main character, how do you develop names? Because the stories consist of characters. How do you figure the names out?
You know, it gets harder and harder and harder. I never thought about that when I got started. But, you know, this is my 17th book. I've finished my 18th book. It'll come out in July. Each one probably has an average of like 40 characters in it, or 30 or 40 characters. So I don't know, someone else would have to do the math, but it is a ton of names to generate. And you don't want to repeat anything. You don't want there to be names that are in any way similar in the same book. I think that's kind of a mess. So I do spend a lot of time, if it's foreign names, I have this very strange naming convention. If I need to, you know, find someone from Morocco and use a Moroccan name, I will go to some obscure thing like the national volleyball team of Morocco, and I will take a first name from one person and a last name from somebody else, and that'll be their name. It's just this, you know, I can't do like soccer or something like that because people could be too famous and it might be too obvious. So I do something a little more obscure like volleyball usually.
As far as names go, this book, your new book out this week, Mission Critical, easy name to remember, and it sounds exciting. But to have come up with this name for this book, how many, as far as searching for a title, did you have other titles in mind before you decided on Mission Critical? How does titling the book happen?
Yeah, I bounce around a lot, and then I'll just write down title names just for something in the future. So, you know, like I'll just jot them down in a certain file I have on my computer, and it's just potential names, and I'll play with them and stuff like that. Mission Critical came pretty naturally. There's a line in the book about it. And, you know, anytime like someone is given a mission or an operation, there are mission critical factors and non-mission critical factors. So in this book, Court has to rescue his love interest at one point, and she is involved in the middle of the mission, but he is told by his handlers at the CIA she is not a mission critical element. In other words, don't worry about saving her. Worry about doing what we're sending you to do. Of course, the court has he's a guy very much chained to his own value system, and he's gonna go off mission to save the woman he loves, and that's what he does. But yeah, I've come up with all sorts of names. Occasionally, the publicity or the art or publicity department kind of nicks the names at the publisher, and they say it doesn't, you know, ring very well. It doesn't look like it'll, you know, add to sales. But usually I get it pretty quickly.
And do you ever consult with friends and family to say, hey, I have these three names, what do you think?
I do. I bounce it around. My next book, next Gray Man book, is called 1 Minute Out, and I was asking people what they thought of that. And sometimes I'll think of a name, and I think it's a great name, but just not for a Gray Man book. I'll be like, that'd be a great Jack Reacher book, or that would be, you know, a great title for a Brad Thor book or something, but it just doesn't really fit for my series.
Because it's so interesting. People certainly get immersed in the book books when they start reading, but also the job of the title, and like your next book already sounds captivating, but the job of the title and the cover of the book help bring readers in and help sell the book as well.
Absolutely. And that's something I learned, you know, along the way in this process, because I would come up with these very esoteric titles that had something to do with something in the story. And then they would, you know, sort of nix them, and they would just say, listen, that doesn't convey what the book is. I mean, you want to brand yourself. I wrote several books with Tom Clancy, or three with Tom before he died, and then four more after he passed away. And if you look at the cover of a Tom Clancy book, the largest thing on there is not the picture of the missile or the weapon system or whatever. The largest thing is the name Tom Clancy, because that's a brand name. And so anything you can do to draw people's attention to that book cover across the room full of book covers is what you want to do.
In the three books that you work with Tom Clancy while he was alive, give people an idea of what he was like and what that process was like and the experience for you.
It was an amazing experience. I was very intimidated by it at first. I couldn't believe that I was being considered. We had the same editor, so my editor knew that I was a big Clancy fan. He also knew that I turned in my work more or less on time. He also knew that I answered the phone when he called, and so he knew I was a reliable guy. And then they sent me up to Baltimore to meet Tom, and I was told it was going to be like a 45-minute meet and greet, and I was up there, I think, about 5 hours until I had to go catch the plane that night. And, we had lunch together and spent the afternoon together, and I had a great experience with him. And then after that, we did three books before he passed away. We had just turned in Command Authority, which he died October 1st. We turned that in September, and that book came out in December.
How awesome. So, as you said, did you finish the next book already, or you're working on it?
No, actually, the next book I have coming out is called Red Metal, so there's another title for you. It's not a Greyman novel. It's a big military thriller involving Russia and NATO and a war at Christmas. And it comes out July 16th. I co-authored it with an active duty Marine Lieutenant Colonel, and that's the next one up for me. The one after that will be the next Greyman book, 1 minute out, and I'm still in the storyboarding phase of that. I need to get some words down on paper pretty soon, though.
So this, like, takes 24 hours a day if you're doing this much work. What is your writing discipline to be able to produce all these great stories?
Well, the discipline comes from the fact I sign these contracts and spend the rest of the year going, why did I do that? You know, because I've written two books a year almost every year for the last 10 years, virtually every year. So it's a lot of work, and they're big books. The seven Clancy books I did are all around 200,000, and Red Metal's a little over that. So it's a lot of work. I'm an early riser, just naturally, and that plays into my advantages. So I get up early, 5 a.m., and then I work as long as I possibly can before, just taking a break. And then in the afternoon, I might do some research, or I might do some other things like that. Obviously, when I get closer to deadlines, people don't believe it when I say it, but I really am a procrastinator. I managed to get it all done. But the closer I get to deadline, the more, impetus I have to really get my butt in the seat and a computer in front of me and get the words out.
And if you're just tuning in, we have the awesome opportunity to be talking with Mark Greaney. He is the author of his latest book. It's called Mission Critical, a Greyman novel. It's super awesome. Also, as you're talking about your discipline, Mark, when do you walk the dogs? Is that a daily thing or...?
It is a daily thing. I have an assistant now who does it some, so I can't say that I do it all the time. I travel a lot, but, I did it the day before I left town for this book tour and the weekend and as much as I can. They get out there 7 days a week because if you have dogs, you know,
yep,
they don't get that exercise at night. They can make your life miserable, you know, staring at you and trying to get your attention and get you to do things. So I usually do it in the late morning or early afternoon after going to the gym, and they love it. The summer in Memphis gets really, really hot, so they trudge along slowly, and they're not having as much fun. But I still know if I don't take them when it's 100 degrees, they're gonna be bonkers at night.
That's right. And we want to also tell people your website is really great. Let's tell them the website address for people.
Sure, thanks. It's Mark Greaney, Greaney Books. .com, and it has information about all my Greyman books, all my Clancy books, Red Metal, which is the standalone that's coming out this summer, and they can learn all about it there.
And what I enjoyed on the website as far as the gray man goes, you have a section there where you talk about the research, you talk about the weapons that Court Gentry likes to use, the places that his adventures take place. So there's a lot of stuff, once that people get to know and enjoy the characters, a lot of resources there where they can dig deeper.
Yeah, I like to do that. I do a lot of physical, like location research for each book. And for this one, I went to London for a week and a half or so, and then I went up to Scotland, to Edinburgh, and then up into the Highlands. These are locations in the book. And so, yeah, I like to do that sort of research with firearms, research. For this book, I went to stunt driving school because, like any spy novelist, I've written a lot of like car chase scenes, but I really wanted to have some deeper knowledge of that. So I went to stunt driving school down in Atlanta and learned how to do things, you know, reverse 180s and J-turns and all these different things that make their way into the book.
That's interesting. I forget what movie I was just watching, but I was paying attention to the chase scene, and actually it was a motorcycle one. But as an author, it has to be different to be or unique to write the chase scene versus put it together on the screen.
Yeah, that's so important. I have to be able to describe things. I go to a firearm school, and I'm the only guy there who's not SWAT or military or something like that. I'm not going to be the best one there. I might be the worst one there, but at the end of the day, I might be the best one equipped to describe the experience. And that's my job. My job isn't to do this research to be good at it or be cool or anything like that. It's to find the words that really root pull the reader into the story, have them in the car as the car is spinning around, and what they see and feel and smell and all that sort of stuff. So that's my job.
And Mark, what would you like people to know? We have about 5 minutes left, but I want to make sure that if there's anything you want to bring forth that you think the readers or the listeners would like to know about, what else would you like to tell us?
Well, you know, you mentioned my website, and I do appreciate that. I am on social media quite a bit. As authors go, I think I'm pretty accessible. And, I respond to all my emails and answer questions and stuff like that. And, you know, the nature of the research, I do end up getting a lot of questions or a lot of feedback, people from different countries and whatnot. And I do a lot of, I have a lot of fun interacting with fans. And so I would hope that people would feel free to reach out to me on any of the major social media outlets or even my website. There's an email there.
And our guest is Mark Greaney. The new book is Mission Critical. Pick it up. It's super awesome. Now, Mark, going back in time, at what point did you decide in life? You said, and a lot of people listening are like, I want to write a book. I just talked to someone this week that said, I'm working on a book. But when did you decide you wanted to be an author, and when did it become a reality that you were able to make a living from this profession?
They're two completely different decades with a decade in between. I decided when I was 20 that I wanted to write a book. And it took me 15 years to finish that book because simply I just didn't believe in myself and I didn't commit the time. I say that, at age 20, if I knew that I had a chance of becoming a published author and very successful, I would have worked at it a lot harder. But instead, it was just kind of a pipe dream. And I had what I thought was a cool idea for a book. But it took me 15 years to finish that book. As soon as I turned it in or finished it, I didn't, I basically just put it to the side. I wrote another book like in 7 months because once I was able to do it, I realized, if you add up all the work, it really wasn't that much work. It wasn't 15 years of work. It was 14 and a half years of kind of worrying about it and stressing about it and not believing in yourself. And then it was another, 6 months of actual, pounding the words out. So I wrote my next book in about 7 months, and it was actually my fourth book, which was The Gray Man, which was the first one to get published. And it was, even before it came out, I got a two-book deal, and it sold to Hollywood. And so I was able to sort of quit my day job, but it wasn't because I had a ton of money coming in. It was basically because I'd committed to writing these other projects, and I needed to be home working all the time. And fortunately, it all paid off.
And, of course, The Gray Man was published in 2009, right?
That's correct. Yeah, the first one, yeah.
So it's been a great experience since then. But also tell people, is there a movie in the works? I think I saw that there's a movie about The Gray Man.
Yeah, Sony Pictures has, they had the option, 3-year option for the rights. And at the end of those 3 years, they executed their purchase of it. So they purchased the film. There's a new screenplay, a relatively new screenplay that they have, and they're shopping it around to directors, and they're trying to get director attached and actor attached. So hopefully they'll be able to green light it. I've sold my first movie rights in 2009, and still it hasn't been made. But so it's not real until it's real. But I do say the checks have cleared, so there. You know, I'm looking at it as the glass is half full at this point.
Well, I think that's one of the components of success for all of us. We want things to happen right away, but patience is we have to be patient in some things.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I have to actively like look for gratitude. You know, and it, you get a little jaded. You know, just you're busy and whatnot. But you know, I just realize I have so much to be thankful for. And I stop and say, you need to punch yourself in the face for whining about this, that, or the other thing, because you've got a lot to be grateful for here, and just make the best out of it.
And once again, the website is markgraneybooks.com. That's G-R-E-A-N-E-Y. Check them out. Mark, let's say there's someone out there, that youngster that wants to write a book. What advice would you give them?
You know, my first piece of advice is to finish something, which sounds very it sounds very trite, but it's when I talk to authors, they might have six different ideas, or they're working on this big tome that they have an idea for. And I tell them, if they want to get good at this, they should maybe write a novella or a short story or something with a beginning and a middle and an end, and they should edit it, and they should edit it again. They should put it to the side and then look at it again, and just get something, even if it's a 25-page short story, get something as perfect as you can possibly make it. And that teaches you all the different parts of the craft. What happens so often is people will write the easy parts. And so, people sort of tell me, well, obviously I'm going to be a writer because I'm working on seven books or something like that. And to me, they're saying, I've written the easy part of seven different things, and then when it got tough, I moved on to the next thing. And, that's not going to show you all the, teach you all the parts of the craft. I mean, the craft is the beginning, the middle, the end, and the cleanup and the perfecting it as much as you possibly can.
Well, Mark, thank you so much for being on the show. Our guest is Mark Graney. He is the author of Mission Critical, the latest Gray Man series novel. Check it out at markgraneybooks.com. Mark, thank you for being on the show.
I enjoyed it, Bill. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. And you've been listening to Successful Living with Bill Knapik, and today with Mark Graney. Check him out and go to radiobill.net for more information. Mission Critical. Very exciting. Mark Graney. Thank you, Mark.